thank you all for joining us for kind of part two of our marketing and branding discussion. And again, I'm Bill Montgomery with 104.9 The River, and we've been super excited to partner with Gerber on this series, and thank Randy and Allison for the opportunity and to invite our clients as well. And so with that, Randy, I'll turn things over to you and to your guests for continuing this really good conversation that helps our businesses continue to grow.
So Bill, again, thanks to you and your group for helping promote this. Much appreciated. Allison, thank you to you for the vision to put this together. I appreciate that as well. Although we did introduce ourselves last time, we're going to do it again. And I'm going to go last this time. Becca, I'll have you go first, introducing yourself and your business, and Megan second, and I'll finish up, and then we'll go and jump in from there.
Hey. Hi, everybody. I'm Becca Apfelstadt, co-founder and CEO at treetree. We're a marketing agency here in Columbus. We have an office in the Short North right above North Star. So this is an image. I have the background here just to give you a flavor of our space. Our environment is a lot a part of our culture and our makeup, and culture is very important to me as a leader. So I'm really excited about this topic. It's a big part of why I wanted to go into business for myself, to create a place for people to thrive, and an environment for them to do so that is unique and special and interesting. And I think we've accomplished that here at treetree. We focus primarily on helping B2B giants as an extension of their internal marketing team. So we're working on campaigns and assets that help drive their businesses forward, and primarily when their sales team has a need and gets opportunity. So that's a little bit more about kind of how we serve clients, but I'm excited for the discussion today and the topic.
Yeah, and I'm Megan Shroy, founder and president of Approach Marketing. We too are a marketing agency, but really specialize in public relations, communications, and social media. On the flip side of Becca calling in from her office virtually, we operate 100% virtually. So our team works from co-working spaces and home offices across the country. And while the world shifted this way 9 months ago, we've been doing it for 10 years. So, you know, building a culture in a very unique environment has been something that we've been focused on for almost a decade. And we partner with clients of all sizes to really help them get the right messages in front of the right audiences. And I'm excited about the conversation today too.
Thanks. And I'm Randy Gerber with Gerber. We are a professional service firm exclusively advising first generation entrepreneurs and short term or short explanation, help entrepreneurs grow their business with purpose. So I've known Megan and Becca for a while, and it's a part of the series. The first one was about marketing. Obviously, today's about culture, and they were immediate thoughts for me because they both have been committed to their cultures for quite, you know, since day one, and they do it differently. And Becca just went through a transformation here, I think a year ago, 2 years ago, lost track of time now. Where she was in an office environment exclusively, and has changed her model as well, and let her talk about it. So we have two folks that have some really fresh thoughts and content. One thing that when Allison handed me the agenda for today, which we did talk about and prepare, by the way, so it's not fly by the seat of our pants. The first thing she put on here was definition of culture, and it kind of like hit me like, well, you know, what is the exact definition of culture anyway? Because I don't know what that means to, you know, exactly. So there, of course, I did what everybody does and Googled it. And there's two definitions, the first of which is the arts and other manifestations of human intellectual achievement regarded collectively. Okay, that doesn't feel like what I do your day to day, but that's the first definition. And the second is the customs, arts, social institutions, and achievements of a particular nation, people, or other social group. And so when I listen to read these definitions, I'm like, I don't know that is really what we're talking about within the scope of a business. Because while you do have the arts and other manifestations of human intellectual achievement, it's all in the scope of being a team and having fun and having a profit. So it'll be down the road, there needs to be a third definition somewhere around, you know, the team building and the respect to build a business or maybe a nonprofit with a singular mission in mind. So I guess I'll start with you, Megan, because you've been committed to the virtual team since day one, and that's day one's over 10 years. And so obviously you knew culture would be tricky in that environment, or it had to be addressed in a non-traditional kind of way. So walk me through, if you can remember, what your original thoughts were around culture development and why you chose the route you chose, and have things worked out the way you expected them to, or are they different? And if so, different, how so?
Yep. Well, I first, as a communicator, have to knock those definitions. Like, what does that even mean? What you just read. To me, culture is, you know, defined by the people in your company and the way that they treat each other and how it feels when anyone, you know, interacts with your organization. But for me, you know, looking back 10 years ago when we decided we were going to operate this way, I come from big agency. And so I was, you know, working at a big agency in Chicago and relocated to Columbus, Ohio, and thought, gosh, it's hard when, you know, our big media outlets are based in, you know, Chicago, New York, LA, and a couple other markets. And why should we be restricted by the geography in which we're based, right? I want to hire the very best talent, regardless of where they are based. So that was kind of the impetus behind this decision. And I'll tell you, selling folks on a virtual agency a decade ago was a challenge. And I think explaining, you know, how we're going to meet and, you know, how we work together as a team was something that we really had to be intentional about and think through. And even a year ago, it had become so much more commonplace. Now everyone is operating this way. So for us, we really had to think through how are we going to answer those questions, you know, to our clients first, and then how are we going to do it and stand by what we say on the back end. And so, you know, we have, you know, invested in technology and developed tools and processes that help us, you know, stand by our core values, which is a big part of how we measure our culture, as well as make our clients feel like they're interacting with any other agency that they have trusted and, you know, become comfortable with that is in one building. But we believe that you can do that and define your culture and build your culture without being, you know, restricted by four walls.
What were some of the unexpected bumps along the way?
I think something that we learned early on is not everyone's set up to do this, right, and have these conversations via video. And so early on, we had to, you know, get creative about ways around that. We traveled a lot more to see our clients, and we were very intentional about gathering together as a team, be it, you know, on individual account teams or bringing the whole agency together, so that we had time to have that, you know, human interaction, which we all are craving so badly right now. But there was a variety of bumps, and I will say, you know, in some ways, the world moving this way has really helped our cause. But as the owner of this agency, it also has made me question, are we losing our differentiator?
Right.
And so I think, you know, we're constantly evolving and coming across new obstacles.
Got it. So, and thanks, Megan, for that. And so, Becca, again, as I mentioned earlier, it was really interesting. We had long, lengthy discussions about this, but the transition from a one office location that was really cool and it had made great statements about your culture, making this transition to a hybrid model. Walk us through the thinking in that and some of the bumps and et cetera.
Yeah. I mean, we started the agency in 2009 and getting an office was one of the very big symbols we thought we needed in order to say we're a real company. Going out and getting I think it was 1,000 square feet. We put a couple of IKEA desks in there, but we had a door and it had our name on it. And now we're official. So the symbol of an office space was meaningful to me. And I think my background coming from an agency where culture was almost a utopia that was actually studied in management textbooks, and professors would come in and meet with my my former leader. And so I got a chance to absorb very young a very different way for our industry to treat people that came from the assumption that everybody is good and not allowing anything competitive, that allows for a lot of collaboration and celebration that's different and unique in our industry, which can be more cutthroat and more competitive, to be honest. And so we wanted to make sure that there was a place where that would not exist. So over the years, as we grew very rapidly, I mean, our office at the Battleship Building was 8,000 square feet, and we threw, you know, everybody in there. We filled it up to the brim with energy and enthusiasm and excitement and our vibe and all of our files and our stuff and our paper. And then things started to change with technology, and we didn't need paper as much. And so we looked around at all the square footage, and it was like, we got all these empty storage bins. Maybe we can reduce our footprint. And then one day I had this moment where I walked in the studio, which everyone worked in this open concept because we liked being able to all see each other's eyeballs and not have offices, because that said something about the hierarchy of the business if we had offices. So we were totally flat, and you know, everybody was all in the same room. And I walked in the studio, and there were like three people and 27 desks. And it wasn't that there were only three people in the building. They were all working with their laptops up into, they were standing at countertops. They were in the kitchen around the island. They were in conference rooms. They were sitting on a bench in the hallway. They were at a coffee shop. They were just working in different places where they felt most comfortable. And it hit me that we have changed. We do not need these big footprints anymore. And so we sought out, and we were actually able to, in our new space, go to half the size by reducing the amount of footprint each desk gets, by sticking with technology to help us eliminate the need for storage and paper. And then we have a lot more little breakout rooms and places for people to hole up. And we're in an area that's very walkable for people to go find a spot inside, you know, somewhere in the Short North, coffee shop or whatever, to have a meeting. And we have outdoor spaces now. So we really sought out this ability to fabricate and create your own version of your day and design your day the way you want. And sometimes that's going to mean working virtually and sometimes not.
And so did that save you, did that choice save you any money?
Oh my gosh. Yes.
Okay. I was waiting for the yes.
Close to five figures.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. It's a lot.
Yeah. Right. So I don't want to spend much time talking about the adjustments you made during COVID, because I think we're all COVID fatigued. But I will ask this question. What are the, from a culture perspective, what are those good things that you're going to continue to do or continue to innovate that maybe wouldn't have been obvious to you prior to COVID? And so what are those things that, you know, going forward, and in reasserting leadership, what things will you do on a go-forward basis? And Becca, I'll start with you, because I see Megan had her, she was on mute there for a second.
Okay. Well, I think that the flexibility that we have now has gone like this, and just the encouragement to allow people to take time and space during the day. To get out and walk. I mean, we had to really force people to get away from the screen. And there are some people in our organization whose jobs prior were looking at a screen a lot. A graphic designer is, you know, they might be doing some sketching, but most of their work is on a computer. So you've got to take those breaks, and we have to build it into the day, and we have to make it more flexible. So just like it was always there, and it was always something that we said we had, but we actually verbalized and vocalized and made a very concerted effort to check in with people. You know, it's a beautiful day outside. Have you taken a walk yet? You got to get your vitamin D. Get out there. So just making sure that we're encouraging the team, and we're not letting anybody sit in their chair too long, I think is a really important learning. Walk and talk meetings have been another thing that we've embraced, and I think we'll continue moving forward. And that has been a helpful thing for our team.
And I don't mean to ask this obnoxious question, because you know, walk-in talks were forced because you were all home. But so when you're back and you guys are back in your space together, how do you make people do that? Are you gonna say go walk? I mean, like, how does that happen from a practical execution perspective?
Well, I will model it. And so one-on-one meetings, in the meeting invite, it'll say, let's walk. We got Goodale Park right around the corner. Let's go walk. And maybe when we get back into the office in some capacity, everybody keeps a pair of walking shoes at the office, and it's just the expectation. Our group likes to be active and fit, and so I don't think they'll have any issue with it. But let's get out and enjoy, go walk down High Street, get that breath of fresh air. So I think it starts with leadership modeling it and making the invitation. And I had a walk with every single team member over COVID, and we met at parks and, you know, brought coffee if we wanted to, and wore our masks and just walked Antrim or did a long walking path and just caught up on life. There's also something really nice about being side by side. Sometimes people open up more. There's actually science behind that. They say that if you have a teenager and you want to talk about an important subject and get them to open up and volunteer information, you should talk to them while you're driving, because if they're in the front seat with you, they will be more likely to be vulnerable and open up because they don't have to look in your eyes. So
I know one change that's happened here that was not driven by leadership, but rather by our team, that every day I hear Crisscross or some Michael Jackson song pumping through the walls, and everybody's out there for 2 minutes, and Annie's leading the charge. Everybody's jumping around doing dance moves. And so it's been fine until they pump it in my office when I'm on the phone with a client. But yeah. Besides, that's a new, it's a new habit that's been adopted. That's been a lot of fun. So that's Megan, great. How about you? What do you see? What change did you learn or new notion that came around that's going to be permanent change for you going forward? And how will you use Becca's word, model that change?
For us, it's been much more about shifting and showing empathy for what's going on in our team's life. Because we worked this way in the past, we, you know, had done things like walking meetings and virtual happy hours and some of the fun things to get team together prior to COVID. But for us, it's been, you know, being more cognizant of kind of the stress and the pressure that this team is under, both at work and at home too. And, you know, because of our business model, we attract a lot of working moms, and, you know, they're dealing with kids being at home and virtual school and kind of the invisible load of running their life in addition to having a career. And so, you know, we've really tried as a leadership team to adopt practices focused, you know, more on supporting them. I think I said this last time, but you know, we really kind of went into this advising our clients that your title as CEO should be Chief Empathy Officer. And I think that that has really become a part of our culture, is empathy. And I think I hope, and I will, you know, make a cognizant effort around keeping that, because the reality is that, you know, when, you know, kids are at home, moms need flexibility, dads need flexibility. I think understanding that COVID has had a very big impact on a lot of people's emotions and stress levels, and being, you know, more human with one another, and, you know, versus, you know, we're running a business, it's all about X, Y, and Z. I think it's okay to talk about some of that emotional pressure that people are under and show them that support. And I think it's become, you know, a bigger piece of our culture. You know, one of our core values, which has always been a core value, is to care personally. But that has really evolved through COVID to incorporate that kind of empathetic piece. And I think that I will try very hard to keep that.
I think so, that's a really important point, if I can chime in here. And we've experienced the same thing. We have a lot of working mothers and a lot of women. I mean, a ton of women compared to men on our team, not by design, just how it's happened. But COVID has really had a disproportionate impact on women. And there's all kinds of statistics out there that the Department of Labor is saying women are leaving the workforce at four times the rate of men. And that this is going to put us backwards in the progress that we've made towards women in the workplace. Mm-hmm. So leaders, I think, need to be really paying attention to how they're supporting working parents in general, and how women are going to have options to have that flexibility and be trusted to do their job and get it done. And so does that have to happen during normal work hours? What additional adjustments or accommodations can you make for them? It may not be equal across the board, but can it be fair across the board? You know? So each individual may not have the exact same guidelines. So we've had to go back and understand if it's fair, even if it's not equal, that's what we're after, because everybody's got a different situation at home.
Becca, that's such a good point. There was an awesome article in the Times actually this past Sunday about this very point. And one of the big themes of that was trust. And as leaders in an organization, having trust in your team that they're going to get their job done in the hours that they can has, you know, really risen as a trend amid COVID, because the reality is it might look different than it did before. And, you know, just because we're not all, you know, logged on at our desks, you know, 8:30 to 5:30 doesn't mean we can't get the same job done and deliver the same results for clients. And I think it's something that as leaders of organizations, we need to be talking about is what are our boundaries? Because they're going to look different for Randy and Becca and myself. And, you know, then clearly communicating those boundaries to our teams so that, you know, we have those expectations and agreements.
So that's actually interesting you guys are talking about this, because one of the things I was just getting ready to ask you was kind of the exact opposite question. That is, you know, with the labor market in motion to the degree it is, and it is, you know, is this an opportunity to right size your team with your values and with how you operate? But what I'm hearing you both say, I think, is the exact opposite of, hey, we're going to change our model to accommodate the team. Versus look for the team that fits our model. And so, you know, the is that a forever thing or for now, do you think?
I mean, I'm a who first person. I believe in, if you've read all Jim Collins' books, the idea that you start with who, you get the right people and then you get them in the right seats. I believe my team is they're the right folks. And they are here and they understand our values and they take really good care of our clients and really good care of each other. And those are the people I want around me. So we will figure it out together and we will pick up the, you know, the things that are falling through the cracks if there's a day where that's happening, to support each other so that so-and-so can get to the doctor's appointment with her daughter and somebody's recovering from COVID or whatever the situation is, or you just are having a day. But we really encourage that conversation. What do you need right now to be okay? Mm-hmm. And it's okay if you're not okay every day.
Right.
Right.
You know, I'm unfortunately familiar with the notion of so many women leaving the workforce. I tend to believe that's temporary. I think they'll find their way back. But that too seems like an opportunity to reengage with some spectacular people into your organization. But to the point that you're mentioning, it will have to be on different terms than it was before. And so with that in mind, you know, with all these folks out there available and interested, and again, we, you know, we hired two fantastic folks that I don't know if we could have done that a year ago, but because of what happened with the COVID, picked up, you know, actually two, three, one just joined us last week, that just super stellar people. And you know, we were able to do it in a traditional sense from the standpoint of interviewing and hiring and training, because that's how we've been set up. But obviously with what we're talking about right now, the whole onboarding and training is different. It has to be in some respects, right? And so Megan, since you know, we'll start with you in this question, because you've been doing it so long, you know, A, how do you do it? And what are the traps? And then the second question with that is, how do you see it evolving from here?
Yep. You know, we have been virtually training and onboarding for a long time, and I believe it can be effective. I think a couple of things have to happen, and that it can't just be, you know, HR and a new hire going through this virtual onboarding. Think about your first day at your best job, right? And you were taken out to lunch, and you probably followed someone around every hour of the day, and you had a lot of individual one-on-one conversations. You know, we believe that's really integral when you're onboarding to our organization too, even though, you know, Randy might be based in LA and I'm based in Columbus, Ohio. And so I think being intentional about giving new hires the same experience you would if they were in the office is a part of that. But I also think, kind of, you know, going back to what you said first, Randy, using this time to think through how your organization has changed post-COVID and what, you know, that might mean for attracting new types of talent. I was talking to a client yesterday, and we're working with them on a recruiting campaign to get new employees in the door. And they were really frustrated that, you know, in January of this year, they had a lot of folks turn in their resignation. And I think that's because following COVID, people have changed with what they're looking for in an organization, and cultures have shifted. And I think it's okay to recognize we've changed as an organization. You might not no longer be the right person in the right seat, and it's okay for them to go and graduate to a new organization, and for your cultures to be living and breathing and evolving. And so I think it's kind of going back to onboarding and hiring. It's taking that first step to say what makes sense for us right now in a post-COVID world, and defining that in order to get the right people in the door.
Got it. And Becca, how about yourself? With what do you anticipate for the onboarding and training and integration into the culture?
Yeah, this we were terrified of, because at treetree we have this very intense process for onboarding, and it's all mapped out, and it's like a 90-day thing to get someone integrated as a tree, which is what we call ourselves. And it's all, when we were in the office, like, we know how to do that. We did that a lot, and we were very confident we could bring somebody into the fold and have them feel a part of it and have them understand how we do things here, which is really how I define culture. It's that common knowledge that we all understand about how we do things here. So how do you do that when there's Zoom meetings and Slack messages and email? And because so much of it is soaked up by just being in the room, in our experience in the past. So the easier part was, how are we going to get them to fill out their paperwork? How are we going to get them their laptop? How are we going to get them, to the right meetings? All of that, the nuts and bolts was the easiest part to figure out. The how do we tell them how we do things here part has been the biggest struggle. And so we had to be very intentional, like Megan said, about that. We've had two people that we've onboarded in this virtual environment, and it has gone exceedingly well. I'm really relieved and impressed by how my team took advantage of the opportunity to explore what do we want to do differently and reevaluate that whole process. And they just really kind of threw out what we had before and said, let's create it from scratch. It's a new world. We're a different kind of company. We went through our handbook and couldn't believe how many things needed to be updated because of this past year, which is how we work. But our office is important. So we did have a meet at the office and get a tour, at least, even though we're not in there, so they can see the space and understand, and they get a key, and we had stuff delivered to their house, welcome custom cookies. And we always give their family a card that's signed by everyone saying, this is welcome. You're a part of this place too. We're really glad to have your person be a part of the treehouse in the forest. And then we have a happy hour at the end of their first week, and we have a presentation they do where they are giving us insight into their past career and more about themselves and their family, do a little spotlight. So we've added some elements like that to really get to know them, but it just feels like they've jumped right in and fit right in. And it is such a relief, because we were really concerned we're never going to be able to hire in COVID.
Yeah. I think that's so good is kind of the part outside of work. And I think one thing that we do, and this is very tactical, is virtual one-on-ones during their onboarding, because so much is lost when you don't have that time in the kitchen, or even like walking in the building, going up the elevator, sitting down and unpacking. And so if you can create those moments virtually, I think it helps, you know, folks build that trust earlier. And so I do think, you know, being intentional with making it not all about work and getting to know, you know, these new folks as people really can help to, you know, get them, you know, learning your culture and building that trust earlier.
Yeah.
So Megan, you know, the more and more I listen to both of you guys talk about this, you know, it becomes really, really obvious to me that this is, it's a lot of work to manage a culture virtually. I mean, it's actually, it sounds like harder.
Yeah.
Than, and so Megan, specifically for you, the trade-off of talent to the efforts, it's got to be there, right? I mean, walk me through that.
I think there absolutely is there. And I do think that there's benefit to being able to hire anyone from anywhere. I also think, you know, that can be created and has really, you know, come to fruition amid COVID, because one of the reasons, and this is a very important tenet of our culture, one of the reasons we do this is because we want to give our team flexibility. And that's how we're able to really attract senior level talent to our agency, is because they're used to, you know, getting on the L and commuting 45 minutes to an office and, you know, being in that office till 6-7 at night and then commuting home and missing, you know, that time at home with their kids and, you know, being on the road with global travel. And we say, you know what, because of the way we work, because you can, you know, be on, you know, in a minute by dialing in, you know, from your guest room on a computer, we're giving them back a part of their day, right? And I think that, you know, that is the reason that we're able to attract such senior level talent to this, is by offering them that flexibility. And I think a lot of companies have seen that amid COVID, is I have a more happy and engaged team in some ways because we've given them more flexibility and autonomy and trust. And I think that's kind of the bigger piece of this. Now, is there work to be done to build culture? Is it potentially more difficult than when you're in, you know, under one roof? Yeah, I think absolutely, because you have to be super intentional about it. And you have to say, we're going to invest in bringing people together. And sometimes as a small business owner, that's a hard investment to make.
Sure.
Right.
The actual cost of it itself, you're talking about.
No, flying 30 people to one location and saying, we're going to, you know, do this because it's good for us to have this, you know, human interaction. But that's an important piece of the puzzle, in my opinion, is making sure that you prioritize that investment.
Mm-hmm. Got it. So Becca, do you see yourself hiring nationally or even internationally now as a result of this evolution of your experience?
We have opened up our mindset to it. I don't know that we're actively pursuing it at this time, but we have had some contractors and people to add to our bench, and it's allowed us to have flexibility to add others in that we maybe wouldn't have considered before, because of it just feeling like if we're all looking at each other in the same room and we have this one person on the phone, it's so much harder to get that collaboration going. So I don't know long-term with us probably being in that more hybrid model where we will have people in the office. But we do have, to Megan's point, people who, like, we have one person who worked from Canada for 2 months this year because her parents live there and she needed to go and care for them. And she just set up shop there and worked from Canada. And we had a conversation about she'll probably need to do that moving forward to help care for them. And she wanted to know, would that be okay here? And I said, we have this great ability to experiment with it in your role. Yes, your role, that works. If it was somebody in client service, maybe not, because they need to be able to run down the street to Nationwide when they want us in a conference room. So it sort of depends on the person, the role, and their engagement with clients in our business.
So talk to me a little bit about innovation and creativity and creation. How does that change virtually versus in person? And you know, I've heard a lot about this from business leaders and CEOs that, you know, they're very concerned about the ability for their most creative people to be creative virtually. And in fact, the early comments I'm hearing, it's not very effective. I'm kind of curious your own experience with that, because that's, again, for both of you, that's one of the roots of what you guys do for your clients, right? And so from a cultural perspective, it's I'm really hearing how great it is for the employee and how great it is for flexibility. I'm just curious, what does that do to the core of your business?
Well, I can answer this right off the bat because it's something we've talked a lot about with particularly those creatives on our team. And that is understanding what works for you and what doesn't. And I think a lot of folks who, you know, are creative get their energy from people. And so they need to be around people and, you know, experiencing their art together, or brainstorming together. And so I think, you know, being upfront and talking about that and saying, this isn't the best way for me to work. A home office doesn't make sense for me. Perhaps instead a co-working space with other creatives, you know, will solve that problem. But I do think, you know, empowering team to talk about the ways that they work best is something we have to do as leaders if we're going to continue to be successful in this model.
So Megan, do you encourage your creatives to physically meet with each other occasionally, even though one may be in Wisconsin and one's in Chicago?
Absolutely. And I encourage our non-creatives to do that if that's how they work best too. I mean, the reality is I'm not a creative person, but I'm an extrovert and I'm in business development and I like being in front of my clients and in front of my prospects to really understand how we're going to set up strategy and to build that relationship early on. And I know that about myself. And so I wouldn't come to my organization if I didn't have the authority to schedule those in-person meetings or the, you know, autonomy to get on a plane and go see a prospect if we're talking about a big project, because I know that's how I work best and how I'm going to be ultimately successful at my job.
I never would have guessed you're an extrovert, but anyway, Becca, how about you? Because again, your history has been rooted in one location and in, you know, I haven't seen your new space yet, but your old location was this screamed creativity and innovation and invention. So
walls, sheets of course.
Oh yeah,
throwing awesome. For feet and feet, you know. So it really threw us for a loop in the beginning. We were concerned, you know, and as the time went on and it had to be longer and longer, everybody's looking at each other going, how are we gonna do this? And I think we learned the tricks that worked for us. And that was making sure those meetings that were collaborative, we had eyeballs and everybody had their cameras on. We had more preparation time in advance. So we would send the brief out and background information and give people a chance to absorb it and come with some ideas, because it just was like harder without that in-person energy to get the discussion going sometimes. So we were almost coming with some in our back pocket and then building on them. There still is that in-person or one-on-one element, I guess I should say, happening virtually, where a creative director will work with a designer one-on-one to problem solve something individually. Some of our creatives though were really happy to have more think time on their own, where they could really problem solve and be more strategic and not be interrupted and not hear the bell ringing in the office and someone cackling over here. And, you know, just a lot of distractions that can happen in a joyful, celebratory place where it gets loud sometimes. So we did have people who said, I love this because just like, let me have the meetings I need to have. And yeah, I miss being in the kitchen at lunch and chit-chatting with people, but I just kind of want to sit and figure out my stuff and make these pieces of work great. But we also offered, if anyone wanted co-working, we would pay for it.
Got it. So when you know, people who want to come back to work and the vaccine's widely available, how do you see in your specific situation, the creative part of your business looking at that point in time? Do you see you doing that back in person, or will you continue the way you're doing it now?
I think we're going to have to continue doing it the way we're doing it now if the creative team is not all present. If it's an all creative meeting, it's really hard. It's like you it's all or nothing, in my opinion. It's hard to have some people in a room together and then other people calling in virtually, particularly
either
for that
or.
Work. Yes. Yeah.
I agree with you. I think it's very, very hard to do a hybrid where some people are in the room and some people are virtual. And I also think that's a conversation that leadership teams need to be having now, because everyone on your team has a different level of comfort when it comes to the return to work.
Yeah.
And it needs, you know, folks need to be empowered to say their level of comfort, and, you know, other folks need to, you know, be comfortable respecting that until we get back. This is going to be a process.
We did the hybrid before, and what we determined worked best was to have days where the whole company worked from home together, and we were all virtual on the same day. And so I think that's probably going to be more of what we consider moving forward. And then, of course, there's going to be times in any other day when you're at the office and you have a doctor's appointment or you have to leave for your kid's thing or whatever. And that's all fine. But in terms of dedicated, we called them focus days, we had them on Mondays, and we just started the week from home and everyone did it. So we all dialed in and you knew that was the expectation. Much harder to have halvesies. That's
we're tough. Finding a lot of clients are having success with that, saying, here's our schedule. On these days, we will, you know, operate remotely. And that might be as a company or as a team, mm-hmm. right? And, you know, we're seeing folks evolve their office space for that too, to make it safer. So they have half the folks, you know, in the doors, and, you know, allow for social distancing by saying, you know, maybe our creative team works at home on Tuesday and Thursday, and, you know, our account directors work from home on Wednesday and Friday.
So, you know, going back to culture, and really it's the, again, achievements of a group of people together. So, you know, the number one reason why a person works for a company is the mission the company's on. And so obviously having a clearly defined mission and having clear purpose around that. The second reason why a person works for a company is the quality people around them. So that's, you know, your responsibility as the shareholder of the company to make sure that you're only hiring the best people. And while we all try to do that occasionally, you whiff and you get things that don't fit. But the third reason why is the respect they get from their manager, which I'm going to throw in the box of hiring people who are great and can show respect. And the fourth is compensation. And so, and this is pretty well documented. And this is, so, you know, again, back to Megan, because you've been doing it so long. Have you seen a change in comp? Have people been willing to trade compensation for flexibility, trade compensation for working from home? Or have you experienced going back to the beginning that you've always had to pay market rates regardless?
You know, I believe in paying market rates because I want to pay my team, you know, for what they're worth. And I think you do have to, you know, pay people fairly to keep them. I will say, though, and this is not my opinion, there's a lot of research based on this, that people are valuing flexibility more than they are compensation, particularly millennials. And there's a lot of research that says, like, when they're, you know, rating, they're much more willing to pay for that or to take a pay cut for that flexible work environment. So if that's something that you haven't looked at, I strongly encourage folks to look at that. But Randy, you know, you and I have talked a lot about the value of paying your team well. And for recruitment and retention, and two, you know, for, you know, attracting the best and the brightest. And so I think it's a balance. I think, you know, going, you know, down the road of some sort of hybrid, probably it was, is what is for the best, right? In that we're allowing them to have flexibility, you know, part of the time or on our terms or with what works for our organization. Not everyone's organization is like ours, where we're gonna do this forever. This is the way we operate.
Got it. Becca, have you had any experience with this at all or any thoughts around it?
I mean, I haven't really. It's not going to change anything for us. I know there's a lot of businesses talking about this and wondering if we do go to that model, are people going to get pay reduced based on where they're moving to? If they're fleeing New York City and going to, you know, somewhere in Kansas, do they get paid less because of where they're moving to? So there's a lot that's out there, but it doesn't really pertain to us. And I think same as what Megan said, and we follow the Randy Gerber guidance as well, pay at market or above.
Yeah. And actually, I think that your A players will still require full compensation. I think that the flexibility piece and the location piece will become just no different than having health insurance and 401k yeah. plans. It's going to become a way of doing business. But I personally believe that those companies that really flirt with the idea of paying less because you're virtual is going to be difficult. And you know, you may pay, the hourly rate will be the same, but people may choose to work less, you know, rather than working 40 hours a week, maybe work, you know, 30 or 20, and that would be a different situation. But it's again, when we're still in this tricky phase, and I think more than ever, because what's interesting about COVID is 85% of Americans did not get a pay cut last year. And so the compensation conversation is very real, which, you know, people have forgotten this, but going into COVID, unemployment was below 4%. It was the lowest it's been in 50 years. And with that in mind, when unemployment goes that low, wages go up. And we really had begun to see wage inflation happening. So for 85% of those people, their expectation still is that, you know, is our full wages. So I think it's an interesting time where we're going to have to adopt and continue to pay full wages, and you should, to get the best people, but introduce these new ways to work with your company. And so, and then Becca, you know, I'm sorry, I meant to say Megan, because you're virtual, but how is managing human resources different, or is it different because culture, think about culture, it's about, you know, the mission you're on and the fun you have. But there's also still this kind of nasty reality of life that you have to have compliance around certain behaviors and benefits and et cetera. So how do human resources work in a virtual environment?
Well, can I say, I think we have far less HR issues overall because of a virtual environment. And I think that, you know, that's a piece of, you know, everyone's kind of, to Becca's point earlier, at home, at their desk, getting their job done. In a lot of cases where when you are in the same building, there's a lot more opportunities for politics to come into play. So is that a benefit? Absolutely. Do we still have, you know, human resources challenges? 100%. I just saw, you know, Bill posted a question about, you know, what's going to happen when, you know, a person should be in person and a company decides that they're going to tell them, we need you at this meeting, even though they are not comfortable going. And I think those are the HR challenges that we need to start talking about now, because that is going to happen. And I think really it comes down to, you know, being clear about our expectations and then making sure that everyone on our team is agreeing to those expectations up front. So, you know, what does it take to be successful in HR in a virtual environment? I think clear communication up front, and then, you know, addressing issues in real time. I mean, we believe in radical candor. That's a big part of our culture, not just from leadership to team or HR to individuals, but across the board, being comfortable and giving that real time feedback, even though we're not sitting across from each other, but being willing to pick up the phone or hop on a Zoom line and have those conversations that aren't always fun, but are, you know, integral to being able to work successfully together.
So, and you know, Bill, it's a great question, and it is something that I've spent a lot of time talking to our clients about. When people say, "I'm not comfortable with that," and you know, the obviously the historically it's been a result of COVID, but I, you know, what we're starting to see, there are people who are simply saying, "I'm just not comfortable with that anymore," because you know, there's been a change of where the our governors have given employees the power to say, "I'm just not comfortable with that." And COVID, employers kind of had to just address it, and, you know, and in many senses accept it. I do think there's going to be, we're starting to see this happen now, where companies, small companies, are saying, "Hey, look, this is a condition of employment." And I think that, you know, to your point, Megan, that we'll have to be really, really clear as communicators to our employees, saying this is a mandatory and this is, forget COVID, let's go past COVID, just when it's all said and done, that this is a mandatory in-person meeting, or this is a mandatory, whatever the case may be. And that's one of the reasons why I think the labor force is still going to be in motion, because people, some folks are just going to want to join an organization where there's that permanent flexibility. And again, I don't think it's a bad thing or a wrong thing at all. I think that it's an opportunity for everybody. I think it's an opportunity for the employee to land at the right home. And I think it's an opportunity for, and in our experience, we picked up three phenomenal people we wouldn't have gotten if it weren't for COVID. And so for that, I'm grateful. And I think that the continued evolution of your relationship with your employees will go. But I do, Bill, that's a really, really great question. And, you know, my opinion early on in this stage is that you as the employer have to put your foot down and say, this is if it really is a condition of employment, make it a condition of employment. And that's a strategic decision, because you don't want to use that, you know, every day over lunch, but you know, you got to pick your battles as to which meetings and which events and scope of things that you want to have people included. So it is interesting. Go ahead.
And I was going to say, and I think defining those up front and incorporating that into your hiring is important too. I mean, even though we're a fully virtual agency and have been, there are functions of our job that require you to meet in person. We put people on, you know, the television news. We have to be able to go, you know, to those news stations for on-camera interviews. But we've always said that up front. We've always said there is one time a year we bring our entire team together. It is a condition of employment here. We have to be willing, you know, to make that happen. And the reality is, as we talked about earlier, your culture and your company has changed in a post-COVID world. And we know that, or in amid COVID now. And so sitting down and saying, what is actually required and what might we think we want people at, but you know, we don't necessarily need people at, and you know, putting pen to paper and defining that.
Becca, you're going to ask them.
I think communication with your team is also just really important, and being transparent about what your thoughts are on it as a business owner, what the business requires. And I've continued to just let people know it's going to be in the interest of this chief empathy officer, we're going to try to find some common ground between what is best for each individual and what the company needs. Because at the end of the day, we're all here to do a job and serve our clients. We have to be able to operate this business and do it to the best of our capacity. So, you know, we're going to do everything we can to accommodate, but there's going to be some time where, you know, and then how can you involve them in some of those conversations, not to make the decision, but to get input and insight into where they stand, so you know more about how to communicate with them. So much of the HR issues where people feel slighted comes down to how it was delivered. I think leaders can really botch it in the delivery, or they can take something that can be hard to swallow and have everybody walk away feeling good about it if you do it the right way. And that just takes being intentional.
You know, one of the things that I still marvel at, and, you know, unfortunately we all deal with this occasionally, but it's still a bad idea to communicate critical topics via email. and I don't mean deceiving leaders, but that's one of the things I really like about Zoom and all the tools we have, is that you can have a critical conversation with somebody now finally and see their face and talk versus do it even over the phone. An email. So it's another opportunity for you to communicate critical topics. So we're coming up on our time. I don't know if there's any other questions. If you do have a question, feel free to post it. Bill, that was a great one. Any final thoughts, Megan? What unfair question? But what's the one big thing culturally you're going to really push forward for in 2021 in a post-COVID environment?
I think, you know, for us, it's all about our core values. And so now is a time to go back to those core values and say, do these still apply? And making sure that we're, you know, doing that gut check and then living them out post-COVID too. Because, you know, we, as we said, and I've said it twice here, we have changed amid this. Your employees have changed, and, you know, making sure that, you know, they're still aligned with those core values is going to be integral.
Yeah. Great. Becca, how about you?
I think we're going to go back to trying to make culture first. I mean, I think COVID really took the focus off of, how does everybody feel and how is this environment? I mean, we got into PPP and clients are canceling projects and what are we gonna do? And, you know, just really kind of responding to everything. And we got through it, but now that the dust has settled and we've come out, I mean, I was just talking with somebody, it's like we ran away from the burning building and we're fine. Let's go get our swagger back now and be celebratory and joyful and, you know, be powerful and confident and go out there and do that together. So that takes getting the team engaged a little more, doing some more activities where we're learning about each other, doing workshops together, having speakers come in, doing those extra things that we kind of just said the extra doesn't have time right now because they didn't have the brain space for it either. Everybody right. was just kind of in survival mode. Well, now we've all normalized and it's nice to incorporate some of those things. So it's culture first for us.
You know, for me, and culture has always been super critical. And one of the things that whacked me straight in the head was, you know, how culture changed so rapidly because of COVID. It was, you know, so quick. You know, the chief empathy officer notion is, I think it's perfect. And with that in mind, flexibility too, because, you know, we all recognize flexibility is more important than it ever has been. And we have to get really good at doing that. So we do have one last question, it seems. And how do you think HR should handle issues related to desk sharing now that the big corporations are consolidating their real estate footprint, asking employees to share desks on a certain day during pandemic and post-pandemic? So I think during the pandemic, that's going to be a tough one to do regardless. And I don't know that post-pandemic that I'd be surprised to see that's going to be a thing in desk sharing. Because I know that for this very topic, and obviously there's certain industries that are difficult, but I think that there's a permanent trend around having space. I mean, I know we reconfigured our office, you know, because of COVID, and we're not going back. You know, we are absolutely, people are going to have their space. Just even the flu, you know, and just general things that people aren't getting sick now, and it's because they have space. And I think that desk sharing may be in its final days. I don't see that becoming a new trend. Megan?
I was going to say, we work with one of the leading manufacturers of office furniture, and the office of the future is a very hot topic in the news right now. And I think, Randy, to your point, you know, we have to evolve our workspaces. You know, desk sharing became a big trend, just like the open, you know, concept became a big trend. I think the next big trend is a flexible workspace, right? One where we can bring folks together, but then we also have spaces for them to work individually in a safe way. And there's a lot of new products and innovation out there that will allow that regardless of the space.
Becca, I'm gonna add that or...
Yeah, I mean, it was certainly a big trend, and we considered it for our new spaces. We consolidated our footprint. Do we go to what they call hoteling, where you just kind of walk in and pick a desk and sit down, and there's pens and a monitor, and you plug in, and maybe there's a locker for your desk, but you don't have anything assigned. And we went against that because everybody gave very vocal feedback that that wasn't going to work for them. And that was fine. We figured out how to just reduce the footprint. So there are businesses that win on that trend, and I'll be curious to see if it means that they have to get extra space or if they just use the alternating days to accommodate and do more cleaning in between.
What we're seeing with a lot of clients right now too is nothing permanent. It's evolving spaces.
Yeah. Because
we know that this is going to continue to evolve. People's comfort levels are going to continue to evolve. So it's okay for it not to be forever, but for right now, we're going to do X.
Right. Well, thank you, everybody. Appreciate the time. Once again, Becca and Megan, and really, you guys are both brilliant and insightful and forward thinking. I appreciate that very much. So, and Bill Montgomery and 104.9 The River, thanks for having us as well. And I'm going to sign off, and that's it.
Thank you, everyone.